Hello everyone, I'm Swapnil Paul. I got an All India rank of 64 in Civil Service Exam 2017. And it was my fourth attempt. In my first attempt, I went till the interview, but could not make it into the main list. In the second attempt, I got through Indian Postal Service, through the reserve list. In my third attempt, I got an All India rank of 431. And I was allocated Indian Revenue Service, Customs and Central Excise. And finally, in the fourth attempt, I'm expecting to get IAS. Service allocation has not been done so far, but most probably, in all likelihood, I'll be getting it. So in all my four attempts, anthropology was my optional. So anthropology, I have been consistently scoring relatively well in anthropology as compared to the other subjects in the other papers in the exam. So anthropology as a subject has been very beneficial for me. So here I would like to share with you the nuances of my preparation and the problems that I faced over and over again in this course of 4 years of my preparation. So first of all, I would like to say the breakup of my marks, how I improved. In my first attempt, I scored 225. In my second attempt, I scored 248. In my third attempt, I scored 287. And in my fourth attempt, I scored 320. So it has been in an increasing trend, and the subsequent services that I got, the most credit goes to this particular two papers, anthropology paper 1 and 2. So what did I do that I could score consistently in a higher manner from one attempt to another? Initially, in my first attempt, I had very less idea about the subject as such. So first of all, the thing which I would like to emphasize over here is to try to understand the nerve of the particular subject that you take up. Because every subject has a particular perspective. So until and unless you understand the perspective or the nerve of the subject or what the subject demands, I think it will be difficult to score. So by nerve of the subject or the perspective, I mean there are particular ways in which you have to answer a particular subject. So in anthropology also, there is a particular way which may not match with any other subject. Okay. So I interacted with people from anthropology as well as people from other optional subjects. So when I shared my strategy of anthropology with the people from other optional subjects, they were saying that their subject demands exactly the opposite thing. For example, jab geography wale ko bola ki main aise aise answer karta hu, geography wale bol rahe the mujhe that if we write such kind of things in our paper, they will cut the marks from here and there. They will just give the minimal marks possible. Theek hai? So that is the difference. So first of all, पर्सपेक्टिव में सबसे पहला चीज ये आता है एंथ्रोपोलॉजी में. इन एवरी आंसर ऑफ एंथ्रोपोलॉजी ट्राई टू इंट्रोड्यूस द नेम ऑफ ए थिंकर. ठीक है, इफ यू आंसर ए क्वेश्चन गिविंग द नेम ऑफ ए थिंकर और एन एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट, बाई थिंकर आई नॉट नेसेसरली द थिंकर दैट आर मेंशन इन द सिलेबस, एनी ऑफ द थिंकर दैट यू नो, एनी ऑफ द एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट दैट यू नो, वो अगर आप मेंशन कर दिए, then you bring the answer in the anthropological perspective. That is the first thing that I would like to say. So in the perspective part, the first part is thinker. Second is the name of books that he had written, if you remember any of the books or the journals. If you don't remember, then also it is fine, well and good. But try to always incorporate one thinker or the other. Books optional hai. If you know, then it is well and good. If you don't know, phir bhi it's okay, no problem. Okay. Try to answer the question giving an instance of a field work of that particular anthropologist. Theek hai? Try to be culture relative. you should not have an ethnocentric point of view. By ethnocentric and cultural relative, I mean there is a concept in the syllabus also that you should be neutral while analyzing any cultural elements. Okay, you should not give out value statements. Okay, and finally, holistic. By holistic, I mean जैसे अपना syllabus है उसमें we have physical anthropology which deals with the biology of mankind, socio-cultural anthropology which deals with social society and culture, Indian anthropology that is also a part of social cultural anthropology only, where we study mainly the rural India and the various elements of traditional Indian culture, and the tribal India. Okay, so you should take into account all the aspects that affect mankind. So by holistic I mean that. So these are the five things that you should remember while writing answers, while thinking about any particular topic in this subject, because these five things will bring the answer or your thought process into the perspective of that particular subject. Are you clear? Any doubt on this so far? Okay. So now, coming to how to start with the preparation of anthropology, then we will go to how to read, then we will go to how to write, and then how to add values to the things that you have written. ठीक है? So सबसे पहले, when you start off with the subject, you have to know what the subject is about. ठीक है? So what the subject is about, the first thing that I always say, don't start off the preparation of any subject, not only anthropology, even general studies, without having the syllabus by your side. ठीक है? सबसे पहले syllabus लीजिए. You should have a printout of the syllabus always while you study any subject, especially anthropology, because there the books are very bulky. The materials are also very bulky. So if you don't know what is there in the syllabus, you can beat around the bush and keep moving from here and there, and ultimately you won't get any output. ठीक है? तो सबसे पहले take the syllabus. Syllabus में either line by line or any way you want, take up a particular topic of the syllabus. ठीक है? And every topic of the syllabus, consider every topic of the syllabus to be a question. ठीक है? If you don't consider any particular part as a question, you will just read it. Okay, you won't have those kind of insights which are required for writing an answer. So at the very outset, when you start your preparation, either there are materials in the market having a large number of questions on anthropology of the previous years, and I'm saying you most of the questions get repeated. ठीक है? And there is this standard which is the syllabus, in which every topic makes one or two question. ठीक है? So consider every topic as a question, and then try to read that particular thing from the perspective of writing an answer. ठीक है? So after that, what to do? Read that thing, try to frame an answer on your mind from that particular book or material, whichever you are referring to. After you have done that exercise, suppose don't read, try to read everything. Suppose you start off with the first topic, meaning, scope and development of anthropology. So you have read the entire thing from any book for this particular topic. Now, until and unless you consolidate that thing that you have read, your task is not done at all. Because I am saying you, in this humanities subject, the most important thing is to remember the nitty-gritties. You would remember what is anthropology about, what is its scope, and what has been the course of its development. But definitely you won't remember anything that you have read. And so, in order to remember the things that you have read, try to make a 20 mark answer after you have consolidated it. Because there are n number of sources, you have to add values in due course of time. Just make a structure of what you have read in that particular topic and then write it so that this structure becomes your core material. The next time, whatever you read, whatever extra things you read from any other source, that will be a value addition to this particular structure or the answer that you have made. ठीक है, so इससे क्या फायदा होता है? The first thing is that you have a complete structure of the answer. So irrespective of the number of times you have to write this answer, your structure will be the same. ठीक है, and secondly, you will just keep on adding values that will lessen your efforts by a large amount. क्योंकि बार बार अगर आप आंसर चेंज करते हो तो आपको दिमाग में भी कुछ नहीं रहता है, and secondly, हार्डवर्क भी बहुत ज्यादा बढ़ जाता है. सो वंस यू हैव अ स्ट्रक्चर, डोंट चेंज द स्ट्रक्चर, कीप ऑन एडिंग वैल्यूज. ठीक है, हाउ टू रीड एंड देन टू राइट डाउन. आफ्टर यू राइट डाउन, द नेक्स्ट स्टेप कम्स इज वैल्यू एडिशन. ठीक है, एंड इवन इफ समबडी डज नॉट वॉन्ट टू राइट डाउन, देयर आर लार्ज नंबर ऑफ एन नंबर ऑफ सोर्सेज इन द मार्केट वेयर यू वुड गेट रेडीमेड क्वेश्चंस एंड आंसर. But I would suggest, read it, it's fine, make the structure from them, that is also fine, but don't follow them completely, because in order to score higher on the higher side, because ek to ye hai ki anthropology mein question bahut aasan aate hain, the questions are always repeated, whatever question is asked in the paper has come once or the other time before in UPSC, so almost everyone who writes the paper knows every answer. But why is there a differential in marks? It is because of the value addition part that one needs to do. Okay? So now we have done reading of a particular part from the books, then we have consolidated in mind, then we have jotted down whatever points or the complete answer based on what consolidation we have done in our mind, and the next step comes value addition. So for every topic in anthropology, you have to follow these four steps. So the steps are: read, consolidate, write, add values. Done. So now we will go into the details, because it is a oversimplified form, it is not as simple as it looks like, because this reading, every step consists of a large amount of effort you have to put in. So prima facie it looks very simple. Now we will see the nuances of every step, taking into account every part of the syllabus one by one. So now we are into the main course or curriculum of the examination. So first of all, the scheme of anthropology consists of four major parts in the syllabus. First is physical, second is social cultural anthropology, third is the Indian anthropology part, and the fourth is the tribal India part. The first two parts that I have mentioned are in paper 1, and the second two parts are in paper 2. Apart from that, there are some other topics like archaeological anthropology, fossil remains and all that we study over there, then population studies, etc. Those kind of things are also there in the syllabus, but they are not as major as the parts that I have mentioned, those four parts. So first we will delve into physical anthropology. So first of all, in any subject, you in the even in the curriculum mentioned in UPSC, you have to know about that particular subject. Okay, here is a main branches of anthropology, their scope and relevance. Under this, there is this biological anthropology. So it is an answer itself in itself, and the entire thing that you would write in the answer is a topic in it, in the syllabus. Okay, so for physical, the core source that I had followed was P. Nath. Okay, there is a physical anthropology book by P. Nath. But while reading those books, just be careful that you don't read cover to cover, because that is not required. Okay. So physical anthropology, the beauty about physical anthropology is that it is a science subject. Everything is very technical. Everything is biology. Okay. So you get marks on a very higher side if you are able to write the question. So first of all, I have started off with physical anthropology because you know the scheme of the question paper of anthropology or any optional subject. There are 5 questions in section A of 10 marks each, which are compulsory. Similarly, in section B, there are 5 questions which are compulsory of 10 marks. You have to attempt those questions. Then there are 6 other questions. Six other questions in which there are 3 questions each. Out of those 6, you have to attempt any 3 in such a way that one at least is from one particular section. So the compulsory question, there is no point in rationalizing because you have to attempt everything. As far as those broad questions are concerned, which are of 20 and 15 marks, there are generally confusions among the students of regarding the fact that which one is to attempt and which one to not. So I would say if all the questions are prepared in 2 set of questions, one is from social cultural and the other is from biological anthropology, go for answering physical anthropology, not social cultural. Because physical anthropology, since it is it has a technical side, you can score better in that. That is the first thing. Okay. So after that, how to write answers in physical anthropology? Unlike social anthropology, in most of the answers in physical anthropology, there are no thinkers or no biologists. If there is one, you can quote it. But if there is none, you need not. If there is a question in genetic load, then definitely you will have to quote Haldane. Okay, because he was the one who quoted the term. So in many topics in physical anthropology, there are no particular thing mentioned in the book about the thinkers and all. So this model does not directly apply to physical anthropology. This is the first thing. Second thing about physical anthropology is that you need not think much. Whatever you understand, you just write the answer in that way. Whatever you understand, there is not a particular fashion that you have to write those answers. Since it is science, you have to just explain the things or you have to address the question. Okay? The third thing in physical anthropology is the diagram. Because in questions like characteristics of primates or the comparative study between man and apes, which was asked last year, and the fossil remains, diagrams becomes very necessary. Because just writing the answer, everyone would write it. So the only way you can make a difference is the diagram. And the most important thing that you have to remember about physical anthropology is that since we are reading the same topics in the subject of biology and anthropology, always try to give a social or a humanitarian angle to your answers. For example, the question asked may be from epidemiological or nutritional anthropology, but epidemiological, suppose the questions are asked on diseases. The disease not only affect the biology, it has immense impact on society, culture, and every walks of life of people. Okay, so once you do this requirement, that is holism of anthropology, will be fulfilled. So remember that in physical anthropology, don't consider that question to be only biological. Try to incorporate the other parts of society, culture, etc., which are impacted by that particular thing. Suppose the topic is on fertility or mortality. So fertility and mortality, grossly you can write an answer based on a biological or technical sense. But what is the effect of fertility or mortality on human society? For example, you can quote case studies even in physical anthropology. Suppose there is a question on fertility and mortality, you can quote the case studies of the Parsi community. And there is a recent scheme by Government of India that Geo Parsi. So that the number of people in the Parsi community increases and depopulation can be reined in. Okay, so I mean, don't just confine yourself to a particular thing. Think in a wide way. That is the most important thing. So the next thing that you need to do in physical anthropology is that try to make the answers vivid. Because most of the time we tend to write things in paragraph, neither we underline nor we give any headings. So at that point of time, nor we give diagrams, at that point of time what happens? You have written everything, but the examiner won't get a feel-good feeling of what you have written. It might be that you have written all the possible things that could have been written in that particular answer, but you have not underlined, so that is not coming to his or her eyes. So in that way, this underlining or writing the answers according to the heading, giving diagrams, giving a vivid representation of whatever you are trying to express through paragraph would fetch you more marks. Okay? So physical anthropology mein diagram, incorporation of social relevance of that particular physical phenomena and making it holistic, and finally highlighting it. And always prefer physical over social cultural, not necessarily. If you feel that you are supposed to write an awesome answer in social cultural, then there can be exceptions. I am saying it for the general cases. Okay. And as far as the sources are concerned, don't read it cover to cover. Take up a particular part, take up the syllabus, see which parts are there in the syllabus, take up that particular page and read it, and then form a crisp answer based on that. Okay? So that is all from the physical anthropology part. Now coming to the social cultural anthropology, which is the real base of anthropology that we deal with in the subject. First of all, social cultural anthropology, you have to remember the things that I have mentioned over here. Ideally you should start off with the name of a thinker, then field work, cultural relativism, holistic. So in that way, what happens? First of all, you are going into the perspective of the question and you are breaking the answers. In optional or even in GS, the more you break the answers, the more it becomes vivid to the examiner that you know a lot of things. If you don't break the answers, your answers tend to be very unidimensional, and secondly, he or she who is checking your answers will get a feel that that person does not have much wide base of knowledge about that particular topic. So break your answers. Okay, so first of all, in introduction, make it a habit that whenever you start writing an answer about a particular theory, about any definition, this particular theory was cultural ecology, for example. Cultural ecology, if there is a question on cultural ecology, start off the answer with the theory of cultural ecology was propounded by Julian Steward. That is the first line, and underline Julian Steward. Okay, so now I'll write down the crisp points so that it becomes easier for you. Underline, very important. After writing that cultural ecology theory was propounded by Julian Steward, underline Julian Steward. Okay, so the next thing, if you remember the name of the book of Julian Steward, then also it is well and good. Even if you don't, then also it's okay. After that, the next thing that you have to write is explain. Definitely, since the question is on cultural ecology, we have taken this question as a model. You have to explain what cultural ecology is. That you can do in your own words also, incorporating one or two concepts which have been mentioned by Julian Steward himself. Okay. The next thing, you can link cultural ecology to neo-evolutionism. Okay. So you have linked cultural ecology to another concept that becomes technical, that becomes a very technical answer. Neo-evolutionism you have added. Next, try to incorporate your knowledge in paper 1 to paper 2 or paper 2 to paper 1. For example, you can draw parallels between cultural ecology of Julian Steward and nature man spirit complex of LP Vidyarthi. So here you have made your answer unique. Okay. So number one, you have made your answer unique. Number two, you have connected this foreign concept of anthropology with an Indian concept of anthropology. After that, the most important thing for any answer in social cultural part is an example. The better your example, the more unique they are, the more you will score. For example, coolaring or potlatch, those kind of examples have become very common. In this, you can give the example of the pig fests of Melanesia. Okay, because why they grow pigs? The people in Polynesia and Melanesia, they grow pigs because they crop particular type of crops called yam and taro. So during the years when yam and taro becomes very, there is a surplus of these two crops, weeds infest their field. So weeds, if they infest their field in a particular year, the next year also the crop gets hampered. So rather than letting the weeds grow in their field, they let the pigs eat those yam and taro. So next year, if there is less production of yam and taro, again these pigs itself will become a menace, because people themselves don't have enough yam and taro to eat. At that point of time, they organize those pig fests to kill those pigs and go for a feast. Okay. So this example, this is a very unique example, and it makes your answer interesting also. The more feel good factor you give to that person who is checking, the more he will give you marks. Okay. So this pig fest, this pig fest is an example. But if you give the example of people, like very common example, that people in Scandinavia and other colder regions take a lot of alcohol. So this is a very common example for cultural ecology. This will be written by everyone. And this is a very general example as well, because alcohol increases the metabolic capacity. So as a result, heat is generated in the body. So the culture mandates that during colder times, they have to take alcohol and meat. So this is a very common example. This will be written by almost everyone. So in this, if you give the example of pig fest, which is a unique one and a very interesting one, definitely you stand to get more marks in that particular question. Then after underlining explain example, the next part is alternate views or criticisms. Okay, so here you can write that, you can write even general things and even the things which are mentioned by some anthropologist. By alternate views, I mean you are giving a critical bent to your answers, because anthropology is a subject which is based on arguments. Even if you read the books of anthropology, there are diverse opinion about a particular thing that is given by, that are given by the anthropologists. So basically, there is an argumentative tradition as well in this subject. Since it is a descriptive subject, it is an various opinions differ, and so arguments, the more critical you make your answers, the better they are. It is not that you have to only put criticism, but some criticism or some alternate view is required in an answer. If it is there, you'll score well. Okay. So alternate views, I mean, you can give that ecology is not only the thing which determines culture. If it were so, then every person living in a particular type of climatic regime would have had the same culture. There are various other things. So such kind of alternate views. Okay. Then You can add another important heading to every answer, that is the functional relevance. Okay, cultural ecology is a theory propounded by Julian Steward. So how is that theory important today? Okay, because whatever we study, it has to have some importance or relevance today, only then it is to be studied, or else we can discard it. So writing the functional relevance give the examiner a feeling that you know that how this particular thing is relevant in today's world. You can link it with the problem of tribal displacement, okay, or the political problems faced by tribes as a result of the imposition of the state society on them. Okay, so those kind of functional relevance, these are different from examples. Examples are the international well-known or unique examples that you put. Functional relevance is just to bring the concept into a micro level. Macro, this is a macro concept. You know the macro-micro differences. Macro means that is applicable, universally applicable to everything. How you bring that macro thing into a micro reality? That will also score you more, because they will get a feeling that you know what is the utility of that particular thing. And secondly, it also adds to your perspective, because as functional view, or that is propounded by Malinowski, it becomes an integral part of anthropology. Fine. And at the end, write conclusion. By conclusion, you sum up the points, everything that you have written in the answer. After you sum up, you just connect the summing up to a particular ideal that you seek to get through following the above steps. Okay, by this I mean that summing up the above points lead us to the conclusion that cultural ecology is still very much relevant in today's world, and keeping this particular theory in mind would lead to betterment and benefit to such vulnerable sections, which in turn would lead to furtherance of this article of the Constitution, or would lead to furtherance of this particular SDG. Okay, so in that way you have given a very wide and futuristic approach to your conclusion as well. You have content, you have given a perspective, you have given the alternate viewpoints, you have given a functional relevance, and finally you have given a crisp conclusion saying that doing all such things or following, keeping this in mind, would lead to benefits to such and such people. Okay? So give me a particular topic of cultural anthropology so that we can analyze another answer in this fashion. Marriage. Definition and what? Okay, marriage. Now there is a common question about define marriage, okay, or how, what are the types of marriage or rules of marriage. Okay, so define marriage, why do they ask define marriage? That is the first thing that you need to think, because that is a very simple thing. Kathleen Gov has given one definition, okay, Malinowski has given one definition, Quares Notes and Queries 1951 has given the first definition. So, but why are they still asking the question of definition of marriage? Because we have so far not reached any conclusive universal definition of marriage. So, if the question is define marriage, the first thing that you need to give is to give the alternative views about marriage. For example, what is the view of Notes and Queries and Kathleen Goff? They have given the view of marriage based on the legitimacy of the children born out of that marriage. Malinowski has given a functional definition. Okay. Then Edmund Leach has also tried to define marriage, and in the process he has given the functions of marriage. So there are various views. Some say that only legitimacy of the child is the matter of concern in marriage. Some say that it is not only the legitimacy of the child that is concerned in marriage. Some say that marriage is the unit which forms family, and family in turn forms the social groups which in turn form the social society. So marriage is the basic unit of society. So you see, there are myriad views about marriage itself. So in that way, first of all, you are making your answer critical. That is one of the most important of the argumentative tradition of anthropology. And secondly, you are understanding what was the meaning of asking that particular question. ठीक है? Because we have not reached a conclusive definition on marriage, so it is asked over and over again, define marriage. ठीक है? So after that, suppose there is question, define marriage, you have to write it in this way. You have to give various viewpoints and finally come to the conclusion that we see, due to the variety of thoughts and views about marriage, a particular conclusive definition and all encompassing one has not been reached so far. Efforts are still on the way, but clubbing everything can give one a wholesome view of what marriage is for. Clubbing all the definitions, because you can't discard one and you can't take one solely. Okay, so in that way you can give the conclusion. ठीक है, now coming to the question of the types of marriage, okay, or the question of how to acquire mates. So such kind of questions are so common and the answers are also so common, that marriage by consent of adults, marriage by eloping, okay. So this kind of things are very common and this is known to everyone. So the only difference, suppose polygyny, polyandry, polygynandry, monogamy, this kind of things are known to everyone, and if the question asks, the answer structure will also be that only. The only thing that you can make difference in this kind of question, suppose types of marriage, the simple question is types of marriage. We all know that monogamy, polygamy, under polygamy there is polygyny, polyandry, polygynandry, group marriage. Okay, so we all know female marriage, ghost marriage, we all know that these are the types of marriage, and everyone who is writing the anthropology paper will write those things. The only difference that you can make in those answers are through this part. Example: the more unique your example is, the more you will fetch, because out of the 50 papers checked in anthropology, 40-45 will write the same Nayar marriage, will be written by everyone. Okay, polyandry. So you try to take any other example apart from Nayar marriage, not necessarily in India. Okay, so that will score you, that will help you score better. This is the first thing. Second thing that we generally don't emphasize while writing these answers is that we try to confine ourselves to only the question that is asked directly, that is types of marriage. Along with the types of marriage that you mention, suppose polygyny. Why do polygyny exist in a particular society? What are the perks of having more number of wives? There, for every point that you mention, you can give example for every point. For example, there is a tribe called Siwu in Polynesia. On an average, every person has 5 to 10 wives, and there are families which have as many as 16 to 20 wives. So what is the cultural relevance of having so many wives? Because there are agricultural society, they need more labor. Okay, so more wives, more children, so there is no shortage of laborers. Now coming to polygyny, a current example, there is a country called Eritrea. In Eritrea, it has been in news that they are proposing some law such that a person should at least have 3 or 4 wives. Why is Eritrea framing a law to mandate polygamy when the entire modern world is going towards monogamy and they are rejecting polygamy completely? In Indian society, definitely every one of us are of the same view that monogamy should be the pattern. But why are the Eritreans thinking just the reverse way? Because in Eritrea is a civil war ravaged country, a large number of men died due to the war. And as a result, a large number of women remain spinsters throughout their life, which make them more vulnerable. So the law mandates the man to take 3-4 wives. So this adds this particular dimension of anthropology, that is cultural relativism. We should not judge, at least in the subject, personally you can judge, that is a different thing, I am not saying that. For the subject point of view, anthropology is a subject which is very descriptive, and you should see the reason, what is the functional relevance of that particular thing. So in that answer, for the types of marriage that you mentioned, just give one or two functional relevance, why are they practiced? For example, monogamy. Monogamy is mainly found in modern industrialized urban society. Why? Because there are various reasons. In urban society, already the cost of living is high. Second reasons, women empowerment. Women are very empowered. So polygamy and all are not in consonance with that trend. Okay. Then there is this modern values, which is for a single bonding throughout the lifetime. So these are the reasons why monogamy is followed in the industrial world. But in countries like Eritrea and in amongst various tribes of Polynesia and Melanesia, polygamy is followed. Is it clear? So types of marriage, yes, simple question, rules of residence, rules of descent. In those kind of questions, remember, don't just write the things that are the headings that are mentioned in any book or that will be written by everyone. Try to give a functional relevance. Without functional relevance, what is the point of studying this particular subject? Okay. Now, the same model you have to follow for all the topics like marriage, family, kinship, economic, political, religion. Okay, these five, six topics follow the same pattern. First of all, mention the name of the thinker, define it, then give the main salient points that are asked to you in the question, then try to incorporate functional things. Without functional things, it becomes very shallow. And most importantly, write good examples. Okay, any other question from this part that you'd like to analyze? Finding the examples, there are stages of preparation. For example, if somebody has to write mains in 3 months in this year and one is not prepared, then I would not say going through all those things, because you just take up a full-fledged comprehensive coaching material and go through them and write the answers that are mentioned over there, because in 3 months it is not possible to add values. Okay, so if you have time, suppose somebody is attempting next year or one has to attempt in subsequent attempts, so in that you can go through n number of books. For example, there is a book called Ember and Ember. Okay, then there are various anthropological sites. Okay, you just Google about anthropology marriage, you will get n number of sites, n number of people giving n number of examples about those things. Just take up, and please don't beat around the bush, don't keep on looking for examples, just go to that particular chapter or that particular site that is mentioned and just pick up the example. No need to read anything else, don't change the structure. Okay, so Ember and Ember is a very good book in that way, in order to take up the examples. Then particular book for social cultural, there is a Nadeem Hasnan social cultural anthropology that can act as a base source to read. Then there is a book called In Search of Ourselves by Ved sir, N.K. Ved. So these are the two books that I referred to for my.
What has to the flow of the reference? You say somebody starting.
No, no. In the starting stage, just go through the basic books or any coaching material that you get. In order to understand the structure that I have mentioned, read, consolidate, write, and then add values. Okay. First of all, take up an easy book like Veds, In Search of Ourselves, or Social Cultural Anthropology by Nadeem Asnan, or any of the coaching material that you get. After that, read it, try to consolidate it, write the answer. Once you have the answer written, then try to make your answers unique. Because before you have any structure, before you have any idea about that particular topic, how will you keep on adding examples? Okay, example has to be added as a add-on to the answer that you have written. Okay. Anything else about social culture? So you have understood the crux of how to write answers in social cultural. Yes. So now coming to, good that you have taken up this thing. So anthropological theory becomes very important, and especially when people have fared so well in anthropology this year. So definitely I believe that the question won't be as easy as this year in the subsequent years. It may be tougher also. So if physical anthropology is asked more, since I have given it for the 4 times, if there are more questions on physical anthropology, we consider that paper to be easy. Okay. And if there are more questions in theory part, we consider that paper to be on a tougher side. Because first of all, in theory, the concepts are very complicated. You have to understand them. You have to remember them. And the third most important thing is that in theory part, since it is a base anthropological part, try to avoid those questions, because marks code, I feel, because in my attempts in which I appeared the theory questions, the marks code are on a lesser side. But it becomes very important if they are to make the questions tough, they would ask theories. Okay, so for theories, there is a book called okay, so you can go through, that is optional, or else if you have any coaching material or the Ved book, in the even in the Ved book and the Nadeem Asnan book, there is this theory part. So this is a book that is generally said for theory, that is generally specialized in theory. So don't go through this book in the first instance. Just go through the Ved book chapter 3, I guess. Chapter 3. Or Nadeem Asnan, in Nadeem Asnan book, every theory has been given as a particular chapter. Okay. So start off in a sequential manner. First go through evolutionism, then diffusionism, then functionalism. In that way you go, what has the way it has been mentioned in the syllabus. Because if you tend to start symbolic anthropology or cognitive anthropology in the first go, you won't understand. Because what does this chapter denote? This chapter in a way shows the progress or the development of anthropology, how anthropology has been increasing from a seed to a tree now. Okay, so evolutionism was the first step, then diffusionism, then functionalism. So first of all, this part is important because question can be asked. Secondly, this particular views can be given in any answer that you attempt in anthropology. Functional relevance is nothing but, I have taken this point from functionalism of Malinowski, which says that every part of the culture is to satisfy the needs of the people. Okay, so what is the need? So you give a point need. Okay, so in that way, that will enrich your other answers as well. Okay, so start off with evolutionism. So we will analyze only one, since we can't analyze everything. Suppose you start off with evolutionism. So there are how many thinkers?
Three
thinkers. E.B. Tyler. James Frazer. And L.H. Morgan. L.H. Morgan. Okay. So these are the three thinkers. So first of all, there is a difference. There are two schools of evolutionism also. One are classical evolutionists and the other are neo evolutionists. So this I am talking about the classical evolutionists. Okay. So any thinker that is given, or if the question asked is about classical evolutionism, the first thing that one needs to do is to write down the first, you write down that this particular, the proponents of this particular school of anthropology are E.B. Tyler, James Frazer, L.H. Morgan. Then there are some technical things that you need to write. For example, for every theory, there is a basic premises based on which they did. From theories, starting from functionalism, there is a particular field work which formed the basis. For evolutionism and diffusionism, as you know, most of them are done, they are so-called armchair anthropologists, because they have done mostly from distant lands and they have given their theories. They didn't go for any field work. So there is no question of field work over there, but definitely there will be a basic premises. So start every answer with a basic premises. By basic premises here, what will you write? Psychic unity in mankind. Psychic unity in mankind. This is the first thing. The second thing is cultural parallels. Okay, so these two are the basic premise of classical evolutionism. Psychic unity of mankind means every in given the similar situation, everywhere people think similarly. And cultural parallels means every society go through the same stages of development from one to another. Okay, these two forms the basic premises of all the three thinkers under this particular head. So this is the basic premises. After you write the basic premises, start off with a particular thinker, suppose E.B. Tyler in this case. Okay, here books become important. Because since it's, you understand, since this is a subject, this is a complete academic subject, and even the ones, I don't know, these are all speculation, but I heard that the people who check anthropology are always professors of anthropology from some distinguished university. So they would expect you to write in an academic way, okay, the way people write in BA or MA papers. So after you have introduced, you write the two or three books written by him, primitive culture, etc. Okay, so after that contribution, after books, start writing what is the contribution of this particular thinker about that particular. First of all, you can say that he defined culture for the first time. Okay. And I would say that certain definitions, this is a cheat code that I am giving you, certain definitions you can just have the spirit and you can write it in your own ways. But in certain definitions like Tyler's definition of culture or Kathleen Gove's definition of marriage, these are some of the definitions which are known to everyone. So write it exactly as it is said in by the particular anthropologist. That culture is that complex whole which includes belief, law, art, custom and such other things which are acquired by man as a part of the society. So you have to write it exactly what has been said by Tyler. Just memorize. Okay. So Murdoch definition of family. So those kind of definitions are known to everyone. So you can't write your own sentence just having the spirit. But for some other definition you can. I'm not saying that for everything you have to memorize by heart completely. But for these definitions which you will understand in the subsequent stages of preparation, that what is known to everyone and what is not. So after you wrote the books, then you wrote the contribution. What are his contribution? First, culture. Second, he gave the three stages of development. Savagery, barbarism, civilization. Okay, so what is savagery, barbarism, civilization, how it progressed from one stage to another, and that he propounded this three stages are to be transcended by all the societies. Now, the most important thing in writing any thinker or any school of thought is the criticism. Okay, after you write down the contributions in detail, go to criticism, and in criticism you would write the views of the future anthropologist on their views. For example, Fran Boas told them, armchair anthropologist, because they just speculated sitting in some distant land. He also called them ethnocentric, because they considered the Western civilization to be the highest level of development. They used some derogatory terms like fossils and vestiges to the present tribal societies or the simple societies. So these are the criticism of Fran Boas on E.B. Taylor and other classical evolutionists. So in this way, it becomes your answer. It makes your answer a full-fledged one. Basic premises, name of the thinker, his books, the contribution. In contribution, you have to write everything. Okay. And at the end, criticism. And finally, you have to write whether this particular theory is relevant in today's world or not. Because it is established in anthropology that classical evolutionism has been discarded. It is not that relevant today, because it is totally ethnocentric. Okay. So it is your own view, but in subject it is given that it is not relevant. But you can also write that no, we can't completely discard it, because people at times tend to think similar when they are in the same condition. So it is up to you how you mold your conclusion. So give a conclusion. So this is the structure that needs to be followed for anthropological theory, because this is the most important thing, contribution, where you have to write everything about a particular thinker. This is the easiest, I feel. The Lévi-Strauss and all are tough theories. Okay, so let's see Lévi-Strauss only, because this is a very easy one. Suppose the question is on structuralism by Lévi-Strauss. You start off the answer saying that Lévi-Strauss is a century celebrated anthropologist. He is expert in this field. The books written by him are this. So after that, when you come to contribution, okay, so contribution, first of all, you have to write here what inspired Lévi-Strauss. Lévi-Strauss was inspired by anthropological linguistics. Okay, and by linguists, who are the linguists? Noam Chomsky. Drobetskoy. Edward Sapir. Okay, so these are the people who inspired Lévi-Strauss to propound this theory of structuralism. So how did these three people inspire him? Because there is a particular subject called structural linguistics. Structural linguistics. There are certain tenets of structural linguistics that would act as the basic premise of Lévi-Strauss. Here, if you write basic premise directly without mentioning all such things, it would come from where did Lévi-Strauss get those basic premise? Those three things, it should be a systemic approach. Then one part of the culture will be related to the other, so that the change in one would lead to change in other. It has to be intelligible, it has to be understood, and it should be simple. So those four points, and it helps one to bring the unconscious phenomena into a conscious level. So these are the four premises. So then he criticized the nature-man dichotomy. This is again the nature-culture dichotomy. So the basic premise will be those four points and the nature-culture dichotomy. Whether it is boiled roasted case, whether it is the study of myths, whether it is the study of incest, in all the studies, Levi-Strauss just came down, used this four premises given by the structural linguistics, and he tried to know what is the nature and what is culture. In the boiled roasted study that he gave, he said that in France, when guests come to a host's place, generally the host gives roasted food. Why do the host give roasted food? Because by giving roasted food, they try to show the guest that they are close in nature, not due to culture. Okay, since in roasted fire comes directly in touch with the food, so it is nature. But whatever is consumed at home is generally boiled, they are not roasted. So boiled food is served to the household people of the same family, because boiled is culture, because boiled require a vessel. It does not directly let the food come in contact with fire, which is an element of culture. So whatever it is, he studied everything with these two concepts, nature and culture. So my point of showing you the example of Levi-Strauss is that try to find out the basic premise in every theory. If you don't find the basic premise, then you won't understand it completely, and if you don't understand it completely, you won't be able to write a good answer. Okay, now if we see the study of incest by Levi-Strauss, he said that early men was not so brilliant, or they did not have that level of intellectual understanding to know that inbreeding is bad. Okay, so in that, what he did, that there are three types of exchanges which take place between society, though it is not for today's world, it is very much against the values of the modern world, but whatever. Exchange of goods, exchange of information, and exchange of women. So these are the three things which create the interaction between the societies. So since incest lead to non-exchange of women, so it is, though it could have been the nature, the culture mandates incest. So ultimately it is the dichotomy between nature and culture that Levi-Strauss has touched in every sense, and these four things which he got from structural linguistics. So in any theory or thinker, you just know the basic premises. Similarly, if we see Edmund Leach structuralism is based in two premises: change of structure, he showed the cultural change, and change in structure. Change of structure means there is a complete change. Suppose a rural society based on agriculture becomes an industrial society, then there is a change of complete structure. But if a village headman dies and he is replaced by his son, then apparently there is a change of structure, but there is no change. This is just a change in structure. So based on these two premises, he gave the entire theory. So my basic point of telling you all those points is that whenever you read the thinkers, try to get the basic cues. the basic premises. If you get the basic premises, you will be able to understand all the contributions, all the things that you had said under that particular thing. Got it? Any doubt? Any other topic that you would like me to discuss in social cultural? Or else we'll proceed to paper 2. Okay, thinkers is done. Now anything else left in paper 1? Yeah, about archaeological anthropology, that Paleolithic, Mesolithic, Neolithic. First thing, that whenever the same question can be asked both in paper 1 and paper 2. So whenever these archaeological questions are asked in paper 1, try to incorporate the sites and examples, the tool technologies from foreign countries. Okay. And whenever this particular question is asked in paper 2, you will have to incorporate examples from India. Okay, this is the first thing. Second thing that I would like to say about archaeological anthropology, prepare answers. Because they are very big, it is very difficult to memorize. Prepare answers in a way that you cover both paper 1 and paper 2 for this part. For paper 1, try to get the foreign examples, okay, foreign sites. So for that, you can go through some notes like, there were some topper, I don't exactly remember their names, some notes were there in insights and all. Okay. From there, 3 years back, I had just wrote down those parts. And if you require, there is this book called D.L. Bhattacharya. Archaeological anthropology. So D.L. Bhattacharya book, this is not mandatory. If you are able to get any notes, then it is fine. But if you are not able to, then you can prepare notes from D.L. Bhattacharya. So what will be the structure of the answers in archaeological anthropology? First of all, you would write the time period. That is very important. I am just saying you what will be the structure. Time period. Second thing is, if you know the sites, the places where it occurred or where it took place. For example, in Australopithecus, there is generally, you have to dovetail these two parts, fossil part and archaeological part, because both of them form a part of archaeological anthropology. You should try to dovetail those two parts. Okay. So you can draw the map if you have enough knowledge about it. If you don't, then also it's fine. After that, after mentioning about the sites, write about the techniques and tool technology. That is the third thing. First is the time period, then where it was spread. Third thing is the technique and tool technology. After that, discuss 3 or 4 sites in brief. In paper 2, if the same question comes, you can divide the sites according to the region. One from North India, one from South India, one from Eastern India, one from Western India, one from Central India. Okay, if the question comes in paper 2. If it comes from paper 1, then you will have to do it in terms of the foreign sites that are very much common. In the tool and technology part, please draw the diagrams of tools. After tool technology sites, you have to, the next heading would be the cultural and social life of the people. Cultural and social life of the people. And at the end, conclusion. Conclusion can be if you have the views of any anthropologist about that particular site or thing, or any archaeologist, then it is well and good. If you don't have, then write a conclusion in brief. Okay. So make answers for all the things that is mentioned in the syllabus, because or else it is very difficult to manage. Sometimes the questions are, in paper 1, generally the questions are very direct. Write about the Paleolithic culture of Europe, maybe the question. Or the Paleolithic culture will come in 10 marks, Neolithic culture, this kind of questions. In paper 2, generally they ask about a particular region, Neolithic culture of South India. Okay, Chalcolithic culture of Punjab. So, these kind of questions are asked. Paper 2 questions are tougher. But there is another source, Nadeem Hasnain Indian Anthropology. There are two chapters, one or two chapters on archaeological anthropology. You can go through that, those two chapters for the Indian part as well. That should suffice. Similarly, for the fossils part, first of all, you have to give the time period in which they existed. After that, the various biological traits like the skull capacity, cranial capacity. After cranial capacity, you have to define what was the structure of the skull and brain. Then you go to the postcranial structure, define the, explain the postcranial structure point by point or in details as far as convenient for you. After that, touch the cultural life of that particular fossil, then conclusion. And in between, definitely, when discussing about the skull, give the diagram of the skull and the brain. And if discussing about the postcranial feature, give one or two diagram about any of the postcranial feature. Okay. So this part is very scoring, I'm telling you. So don't try to miss this part, as fossils and archaeology. They are scoring generally, not like the thinkers part, which are less scoring. Okay. So physical way. Pardon? Yeah, that you have to practice. That you have to practice over and over again. I am very bad at diagrams. So with a lot of effort, I was able to draw a certain representation so that it looks little like that particular thing mentioned in the question. It is not that you have to be an artist and draw exactly, but a skull of Homo erectus should not look like that of Homo habilis. Just remember that. Okay. Ki thoda proportion opportion mila lena. It is not that you have to draw exactly, but Cro-Magnon ke jaisa Australopithecus nahi dikhna chahiye. ठीक है, तब प्रॉब्लम हो जाएगा कि उसका पूरा इतना दूर का फिर भी ऑस्ट्रेलोपिथेकस और होमो इरेक्टस थोड़ा सेम दिख जाए कोई नहीं, बट ह्यूमन स्कल और एक ऑस्ट्रेलोपिथेकस का स्कल सेम नहीं दिखना चाहिए. ठीक है, तो इतना एक्सपर्ट लेवल पे नहीं चाहिए, बट यू जस्ट हैव टू नो हाउ टू ड्रॉ द डायग्राम्स, दैट वुड स्कोर मार्क. सिमिलरली फॉर पोस्ट क्रैनियल फीचर्स. ठीक है, एंड फिजिकल आई हैव ऑलरेडी मेंशन्ड, देयर इज पीनाथ और एनी अदर सोर्स दैट यू रेफर टू. And make the answers and write whatever you understand, giving a schematic, vivid and diagrammatic representation of the concepts. Okay? So that is all from paper 1. Any doubt about it? Any question? Pardon? Yeah. That comes, I have already deleted, rubbed it already. So I have mentioned that first of all read, then consolidate, then write, then add values. So writing in anthropology becomes very important because the books are very bulky, the materials are also very bulky, and at the end of the day you just need to have an answer of 20 marks and you have to crisp it further to 10 marks if it comes in the compulsory section. So for that, consider every topic mentioned in the syllabus as a question and write down the answer. Keep ready the answer, keep the structure same, taki aap subsequent time pe jab padho, you don't forget. Just keep on adding values, but write everything. Without writing, you can't do anything. Okay. And if, and just before the exam, you can form a crisper form of your own notes also. Just giving the headings that this, I will write in any answer. With that, what is the advantage that you get is that you won't miss a single point. Because writing paper 1 and paper 2 itself would make your notes too very bulky. So after that, you need to crisp it further before the exam to revise. Okay, if you do that also, then your answers will be complete in the exam. Done. And then in the notes that you prepare, the there would be hardly 300 or 400 questions in the two papers. Okay, if you prepare those 400, 500 questions well, 300, 400 questions well, then you are through. You won't get, there will be some questions which will be out of your notes, but those will come in the optional part. You need not worry because the compulsory questions are generally the topics in the syllabus. Okay, and even the 70 to 80% of the questions asked in the non-mandatory part is also directly from the syllabus. Some one or two questions are asked very specific. For example, in 2015, there was a question asked on somatotyping by Heathen Carter. So once one knows completely about Heathen Carter method, it is difficult one because I didn't know personally about it. So prepare notes, then keep on adding values. Okay. So this is all about paper one. So one last thing that I would like to say about paper one, since paper one consists of core anthropology subject, so it is basically an academic paper. Don't try to improvise much. Don't try to write your own theory or devise your own theory or devise your own views, because it is a totally academic paper and you have to write based on what thinkers, anthropologists, etc. have said about it. Try to make it diagrammatic, vivid. Try to be academic. Okay. So the strategy will be a little different in paper 2. For paper 1, try to be academic. Okay. And try to answer more of physical questions than social cultural question. Even marriage kinship questions are very easy. But I feel somehow physical is more scoring. Physical questions are tough to remember and all. Fossils, archaeological anthropology, these parts you have to read even the day you write the exam, or else it is difficult to remember the cranial capacity and all. But if you can execute it well in the exam, you are bound to score well. Done? Shall we proceed to paper 2? Okay. See, paper 2 is a very general paper. First of all, there are certain things that I would like to say about paper 2. The questions asked in paper 2 can be asked in general studies as well. For example, whether tribal punch shield is relevant in today's world, or about the gross displacement of tribals in India, or about the caste structure in rural India. There was a question also which could have been asked in anthropology, that was asked in GS paper 1, that can the contemporary caste movements lead to annihilation of caste system in India? So that same question can be asked in paper 2 of anthropology. So how will you make the difference? You can't write the same answer in anthropology and GS, isn't it? So in GS you have to write like a generalist. You just have to mention that thing, write point by point what you think about it, give your own opinion, and then have a coherent structure and then conclude it. But the same question you have to deal in a very different way when it comes in the subject. Suppose the question was about politicization of caste. The same question about politicization of caste, if asked in general studies, you would write with increasing education, with increasing communication, people even in the peripheral of the country are getting politically motivated. So those are general points, that those are known to everyone. So you will give an introduction that there was a Dalit Mahayatra which took place in Una after the lynching of two cow skinners by the self-proclaimed Gaurakshaks. So this is the introduction that you give. Then you write pros and cons about the various things. Then you analyze the topic. After that, you give some added information that government has done this, 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 this. Then in conclusion, you write something. This is what you will do in GS. If the same question of politicization of caste comes in paper 2, you will start off giving the name of an Indian anthropologist who described it. For example, Rajni Kothari, three stages of politicization of caste in India. That is mentioned in Indian anthropology book. So after that, you try to put those three stages to the various communities, various peripheral communities, that these are in this level, these are in this level. Okay. Maratha community in Maharashtra are in the first level. Okay. But other communities, Brahmin and Maratha, are fighting for the political power in Maharashtra. But the other communities are still lagging behind in terms of politicization. So in that way, you give a micro view to the macro question asked. Then finally, you write some critical points that politicization of caste has led to such problems. You give some very classic examples about Una lynching can be a classic example or case study in this case, in this answer. Okay. So in that way, you just write the anthropological perspective, giving a holistic view, and then writing conclusion like in paper 1, social cultural answer. So first of all, what I would like to say is that there are some basic books which you need to read. Okay, unlike paper 1, which I said that you need not go through any book cover to cover, in paper 2 my strategy has been to read the books and the various documents. First of all, Indian Anthropology. If you find some other source, it's well and good. I'm just sharing my own strategy. Then Tribal India. In Tribal India part, why I say don't read it like preparing answers, because strategy is a bit different. You have to know, you have to get a feel, because you see the questions. They generally ask about the critically analyze any one of the village studies of India. So such kind of things are very general. Okay, you need not, you have to improvise a lot in paper 2. Okay, rather than going on reading like in paper 1, reading, writing answers, rather than that, go through these two books. Prepare notes about those questions which are academic at the same time, like dominant caste, Sanskritization, Westernization, modernization. So those are still academic. For the questions that are general, what is the trend, is tribe caste continuum relevant even today? So those kind of questions can be asked for anything. Okay. So there are also type of questions that what is the impact of globalization in that particular tradition of India? What is the impact of globalization in Jajmani system? So for those kind of questions, you need to have a feel of what was going on at that point of time, what has happened due to globalization. So those kind of answers, if howsoever much you try to prepare, there will be some new question in paper. And paper 2 is more scoring, because you can score well by giving contemporary examples. And at the same time, you have a lot of scope for improvisation. It is not as academic as paper 1. So there is a huge scope of improvisation in paper 2. A large number of answers in paper 2 is written from the fodder points that come from GS that you can't do in paper 1. Okay, so this part becomes more scoring. So these two books, Indian Anthropology, Tribal India, obviously everyone would know about the Haha report on tribal development, which came 2-3 years back. So this book becomes very important for the Tribal India part. Then finally you can go through the Tribal Affairs report. ठीक है, and hopefully most of you are read newspaper daily. So whatever you get about tribals and rural caste structure, agrarian structure, just write a note of that particular case that you get. That would come handy in your answer writing in the mains. Whatever thing you get about in the newspaper about these three things, tribals, whether it is tribal art or tribal health, whatever thing you get, tribal, rural agrarian structure and rural caste structure. So these are the three things you remember while reading newspaper, and that would come very handy while writing answers in mains. So these are the five main basic things that are to be done. I suppose I have done it for paper 2. So after that, going into how to write answers in paper 2. See, paper 2 consists of two parts. One, pardon? Oh, Indian Anthropology, both are both are Nidhi Masne. Okay. So now, what will you do with these books? Because in paper 1, I have mentioned you that take every part of the syllabus as the question and make answers. You will get direct questions and you will write those answers. But here, on the contrary, the questions are not as it is given in the syllabus. Okay, there may be some questions like dominant caste, tribe caste continuum, these are just mentioned in the syllabus. But generally nowadays they ask about the trends. Okay, what are the trends of Sanskritization? Has it increased post LPG reforms? Okay, so this will be the type of question which are asked. Dominant caste, is the concept of dominant caste still relevant in the era of fourth industrial revolution? Okay, if they are supposed to, this question was not asked, if they want to make that paper tough. So this kind of questions, first of all, whenever you go through these two books, try to gather the views of the thinkers as much as possible. Because in these two books, there will be a lot of views given by thinkers. In paper 1, you will get them in any book, but in paper 2, generally people keep on writing general answers and they don't quote the academic part. But how will you make your answer different from general studies? Okay, so you need not memorize anything else, but take the name of the thinkers and what they propounded about that particular thing. For example, whenever it comes, question comes on tribal revolt, there would be some thinkers for sure like Surajit Sinha. ठीक है, एल के मोहापात्रा. एल के मोहापात्रा ऑल्सो कम्स इन टू पिक्चर वेन इट कम्स अबाउट ट्राइबल डिस्प्लेसमेंट. ओके, सो दिस काइंड ऑफ थिंकर्स हेल्प यू टू अगेन रीच द परस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द पेपर. द नेक्स्ट थिंग इन जाजा रिपोर्ट, जस्ट गो थ्रू द रिपोर्ट एंड ट्राई टू टेक द केसेस फॉर केस स्टडी. ट्राइबल अफेयर्स रिपोर्ट ऑल्सो विड हेल्प यू इन केसेस एज वेल एज schemes. Then finally, from the newspaper, again cases. So by cases I mean that your answers in paper 2, definitely you would give a descriptive or a comparative view according to the demand of the question, but the answer is incomplete until and unless you quote a case study or the study of that particular thing given from any journal. Okay, Man in India and all, this kind of journals also. But this would over pressurize you. You won't be able to concentrate at all in GS if you go for those things. Definitely, these are good things. So, first of all, again, try to incorporate the name of an Indian thinker wherever possible. Okay, if it comes about tribal development, you can, the question is on tribal development. What are the problems faced in India in the history of its tribal development? Simple question that can be asked in GS also. But here you would start in a way like the journey, India embarked on the journey of tribal development from the time of its independence. In the first 5-year plan, multi-purpose action, multi-purpose blocks, development blocks were created for the development of tribals. So community development blocks were created in the second 5-year plan. In this way, it continued up to the fifth 5-year plan, but not much was done for the amelioration of much of the problems of the tribals at that point of time. Then a watershed was created by LP Vidyarthi in the fifth 5-year plan when he propounded the concept of tribal subplan. Okay, so from tribal subplan, there were various other concepts like MADA blocks. So in that way, you have to write this answer very technically. Okay, and what has been the fruit of every step taken by the government? Okay, what is the fruit of tribal subplan concept? What does tribal subplan mean, first of all? It means that every ministry or every state should allocate a particular amount of money which is in proportion, not less than in proportion, to the population of proportion of scheduled tribe in that particular state or in the whole country. Okay, so that's what tribal subplan mean. But is it followed in spirit in all the states except for Andhra Pradesh, which has a particular law for that? None other state disburse money as in proportion to that of the population of the tribals. Okay, a large amount of money for tribal development are stashed away to the DRDS. Okay, DRDS means district development agencies, district rural development agencies, DRDS. So in the garb of tribal development, the money comes from the center and they are stashed away to the DRDS, and DRDS do general PWD works and all such things. So they don't cater to the niche needs of the tribals. So these are the problems that are faced in the tribal sub-plan approach also. So you see, in this question you have given the entire history in a technical way, then you have mentioned what are the fruits, what were the fruits of those particular steps, then finally you came to the criticism and what, how is it going on. Okay, so again you are making your answer holistic only, but the approach is different. There you were making it very academic, directly from the books of anthropology. Here you have to go through the recent reports, the recent trends, developments, etc. Okay, now coming to the question of what to answer and what to not, my experience says that answering tribal India question fetches more marks than rural. It can be different for different people, but I, whenever I attempted tribal India more than rural India, the marks fetched were more. This is the first thing. The second thing that I would like to say is, as I said, that consider every part of the syllabus as a question in paper 1. For paper 2, get a case study prepared for every part of the syllabus, because without case study your answer won't be complete in paper 2. And preferably the case study should be in the last 5 years or 10 years, not more than that. And if you are not at all able to find any case study in the recent years on that, then you can give the case study of tribal India Nadim Hasnain also, which was written in 1970s or 80s. But still, don't leave the answer without case studies. This is the most this is the more scoring paper, so you should not score less in paper 2. Paper 1 scores a little less. Okay, then finally, coming to how to manage the paper answer writing in anthropology, I used to start off my paper with writing the non-compulsory questions. I used to write 2 sections of non-mandatory ones first, because there the advantage is that you generally, what I did, I prepared 20 marks question for every 20 marks answer for every question. So there, in those questions, I need not think much about crisping those answers, because questions asked are of 15 or 20 marks. I wrote whatever I knew about that from my own notes. Okay, but in 10 markers, the problem is that you have to incorporate everything, but you have to write everything half or one third of the times that you have in your notes. So you have to make your answer a lot precise. So my experience is, in my first attempt and in my second attempt also, I wrote the 10 markers first. I reversed the strategy in my third attempt. In my first attempt, I found that it is very, once you enter the examination hall, you are not directly into the environment. So it becomes very difficult to precise, to make your answer precise at that point of time. It either crosses the word limit or you tend to miss certain points. Okay, because you are not fully into the paper as yet and you are trying to crisp it already. So rather than that, my strategy was that I wrote the two questions from the non-mandatory part, 2 sections, in the first 1 hour. The first 1 hour, 20 minutes, I wrote the 2 questions. First 1 hour, 10 minutes, I wrote the 2 questions of non-mandatory part. After that, I came to the mandatory part, which consists of 10 questions. I took 1 hour, 20 minutes for those questions, those 10 questions. After that, the last half an hour, I wrote 1 section of non-mandatory answer that was left. So in that way I was able to manage the time also very easily, because there is one more thing, one more problem of writing the 10 markers first is that since the amount of time that you put in the beginning of the exam is much more than you dedicate to a single answer at the end of the towards the end of the exam. So you are dedicating more time in a 10 marker than a 20 marker. So I faced the problem of managing time also in my attempts in which I wrote 10 markers first, and at the end those 20 and 15 markers answered turned to be a little substandard. So rather than that, write two sections of non-compulsory first, then two sections of compulsory, and at the end come to the left section of non-compulsory part. So any question? No, not in that way. I actually used to have a particular section on case studies. Like I used to write in headings. Basically, I never write the answers in paragraphs. I start, introduction is without heading. I just write the introduction and then start with headings. In the right hand side, I used to write. I write this thing's heading. Then I start from here. Then again this heading here. So at the end, just before conclusion, again I give a heading and then give conclusion. There is a particular section called case study, and I directly write the case study on that particular topic.
Okay, that. So for all the driver's question, you wrote case study by mentioning heading.
Case study, yeah. Case study, then wrote this case on that without mentioning Zaza. Yeah. Tribal assembly, health assembly, and all were the solutions.
So you have taken solutions from that. So is there any need to mention that Zaza?
I feel that you should not mention Zaza.
Yes, sir.
Because everyone will write about the Zaza report. So I would suggest don't mention Zaza, because Zaza has become very common. And my experience says that the more unique your paper is in the bunch of papers, the more you will score. Especially in this kind of paper where almost every answer is known to everyone, and most of the people attempt all the 19 questions in the paper. So in such a scenario, try to make your answer as unique as possible. Okay, even in paper 1 I wrote a particular section having functional relevance and give it a heading, the headings that I have mentioned before. So that is my way, because I feel that I am more comfortable and my answer becomes better by writing it in sections. If somebody is good in paragraphs, then write it in paragraphs, but make sure that you highlight the catching things, or else the examiner might not know that you have written those points. That can be done by underlining. Anything else? See, my preparation has been totally case study based. Okay, my paper 2, I did hardly, these are the sources I did long back. Okay, so I never revisited also. Most of the things I have written down somewhere. I just revisited those notes, and I prepared case studies for everything. So that helped me in certain questions. Like this time there was a question, critically analyze any one of the scheme of Government of India regarding the tribals. So here I took up the scheme for development of the PVTGs. I took up that scheme and critically analyzed, only giving case studies. I wrote 12 case studies in that. The full answer was only case study based. Right? Starting from the problem of health to food to displacement to deforestation. So for that I just mentioned that these are the problems with a heading, and then inside in the description part I did not write anything but case study. So that was my way of writing, because my paper 2 preparation was solely based on case study.
So this tribal affairs report, will get it from
the site of Ministry of Tribal Affairs. Yeah. Because the case study is the only way you can make your answer go apart from everyone else. I mainly read the newspaper very rigorously, okay. Before I used to even make notes for newspaper in my third attempt. This time also I read. So when you go through the newspaper every day or every 5-6 days, there is one or two news regarding tribals and rural India in the country. So for that I had a separate notebook in which I jot down the case studies. And at the end, what I only did was to incorporate those case studies to the answers.
Sir, you're following Hindu or Indian Express?
Hindu, yeah. Because tribal, regarding tribal rural, you will get one on an average, one or two in every 5-6 days. Okay, you have to just take it, and because any case study that you get would be can be incorporated in one of the answer or the other regarding these three things.
So I.
Yeah, see, there are n number of sources, okay. So, for Anthro as well as GS, keep the base material only one. Because if you keep the base material one, then you would have the same structure throughout. Both are Nadi Masnad book, but both are for different parts. Indian anthropology is a different part and tribal India is a different part. Pinath for physical. That is for physical only. And for social cultural, you can go through Nadi Masnad social cultural book or N.K. Vaid In Search of Ourselves. And nowadays, this time I have seen that there are various good materials like question answer format has been given by Vivek Bhasme sir. So such kind of materials will definitely create disruptions. So this will be read by everyone. Okay. So, try to make your answers unique, your answers, your style of writing elegant, your style of writing unique. Only then, because case studies and all, I feel the ones who have scored well this time, everyone are saying about the case studies. So, even next year, many people will try to incorporate as much case study as possible in the answers. So, that is not the only way, remember. Okay, try to be a little innovative also, it does not matter, not in paper 1, in paper 2 you can be. Okay, rather than case studies, you can give schemes. You can analyze the various schemes of the government of India regarding that particular thing. Okay, or the success of that particular scheme, how the government is acting. Okay, that will make your answer a little elegant. So, in this kind of papers, where it is very easy, so only uniqueness and giving the answer, putting the answer into a proper context would be better, would be good. Anything else? Yes, definitely. Current affairs, the more you put, I am not saying the entire answer to be current affairs, but try to put current affairs as much as possible. Definitely, definitely. CRISPR, Cas9 and all, if you have proper knowledge about it, about DNA technology for human benefits, if the question comes like that. Then definitely you should put genome editing, CRISPR-Cas9 technology, whatever thing that you have, human genome project right is coming up. Okay. See, there is in the syllabus, if you see, in the syllabus, in section 6, in section 6.3, there is a part called developmental projects, their impact on tribal displacement, problems of rehabilitation. So in this section, all the plans, schemes, policies which have effect on the tribals are there. So you should not be surprised if a particular 5-year, 12-5-year plan is asked. But remember that the question would be general. Because I think it was asked about what has been the fruit of the 12-5-year plan on tribals. So here you just need to know what is the main policy of the 12-5-year plan about the tribal. Or there was a question about, I don't exactly remember the question. The question was a similar pattern. National tribal policy. There was a question in 2015 about the national tribal policy and its fruit. So there you just think, when you read this Tribal India book, you will get various strategies. So since the question asked was about national tribal policy, you also know about the various schemes of tribals by the government of India. So when the question is about national tribal policy, you always have it in mind that education of the tribe will be there. Health of the tribes will be there. Communication and infrastructure for the tribal development will be there. Okay, so even if the question comes, try to avoid if you don't know. Even if you don't know, you can incorporate it to the syllabus and write an answer. I have written that answer in tribal, national tribal policy. And even in that year, I scored 141 in paper 2. So try to incorporate those things. Because policy means, remember that policy means it will comprise of all the dimensions, all the holistic things. So if it is holistic, it will comprise of health, it will comprise of education, it will comprise of infrastructure development, it will comprise of employment, it will comprise of psychological well-being. So those salient points which you feel are essential for a person to live will be encompassed in the policy, and you have enough fodder point, enough case studies, enough base knowledge about all the dimensions, so you can write good answer even in those questions which you feel you don't know but you know. Anything else?
Sir, in paper 2,
yeah?
So this tribe and nation state, a comparative study of tribal communities in India and other countries.
Yeah.
So how can we approach this?
So there is a, if they want to make the paper tough, like they did in 2014 in PubMed, then they would ask anything, tribes of Norway and India compare. So generally we don't get those kind of questions and we don't improvise them too. So here for tribes and nation state part, go learn about the basic policies of the important nations in the global arena, like what have been the conditions of tribes in US. Okay, because US was firstly inhabited only by the Indians. Okay, not we Indians, those American Indians. Okay, not American Indians, the red Indians. Okay, so once the colonization started, they were moved to the periphery and they were deprived of all the rights. Okay, so what has been the struggle of the indigenous community over there? This is the first thing that you should know. Just 2 to 3 tribes, Cherokees, then Chickmangwas, so these are the red Indians. You just have to know about those 1 or 2 tribes. Then you need to know what has been the general condition and what have been the policy of United States to deal with those indigenous people. Then come to Europe. There are Lapis and all which form a part of minority indigenous population of Europe. So what have been the approach of the state towards that particular community? So first here, since it is given tribes and nation state, so it's better to mention about the states in Europe, states like Japan, in which the nation, and you know the meaning of nation state, right? No? Well, state is a political entity and nation is a cultural and emotional entity. We are a nation. This statement means that we are a culturally and emotionally bound entity in a particular geographical area. We are a state means we owe our allegiance to a single political entity, that is Union of India. Okay. And what does nation state mean? Where cultural similarity is totally in coherence with the political entity to which the people owe allegiance to. So, in a state like Germany, where all the people speak the German language, okay, so German language is spoken by almost 90-95% of the population. So, in those, why is this added in the syllabus? So in those states, the 5% people who don't speak Germany stand a chance of getting discriminated. So how are they treated in that particular? India is not a nation state as such. India is a state having in this sense large number of nations, because after every 100 kilometer the culture changes, the language changes, the mother tongue changes. So here Japan is only one state and one nation in the sense that everyone is Japanese. Okay, so 5% or 10% of the population who are not Japanese, who have been indigenously settled over there, what have been the conditions? So here you need to study about Japan, Russia, Germany, even US, because in US also most of the colonizers are British, erstwhile British, and they speak English. Okay, what have been the condition of the indigenous people? And here while reading this, just read about the what has been the stance of UN about the development of indigenous communities. Because this time also there was a question, I guess, tribe of India is a colonial construct. Or there was a question in 2014 about, 13 about are the tribes in India indigenous people according to the definition of UN. So such kind of things would come under this. Okay, ki how the states or the nation states have dealt with the indigenous people who have been residing prior to the formation of that particular state only. So you need not go much into depth, you just have to know how has Russia, Germany, Japan, France, those European countries and US dealt with this indigenous communities. Correct? Anything else? Not social cultural, that comes under archaeological or physical. No, in Australopithecus, generally they say that it's better to draw the map of Africa and mention the sites. Okay, if you draw, definitely it is better. I would not say that it won't score you more. Even 1 mark more or half mark more in a question would enhance your rank by 14, 15. So it becomes a question of whether you get one service or the next service, or you are out of the list based on whether you draw a particular diagram or not. So if you can, if it is manageable, then I would definitely suggest you to go for that. About prelims.
Yeah, how okay. You were able to crack the exam back to back. You were in service also.
Yeah.
How you manage that?
Yeah, see, I hope most of you are fresh students appearing for the first or second time. I would say that this is the most important stage of your preparation, because as the time goes by, first of all, you would become a little lethargic, or you would lose the enthusiasm which you have today. If you don't try not to lose, that is the most important thing. So try to get the basics clear, whether NCERTs or the basic books, whatever basic books you refer to. Try to get the basics clear. Don't try to take much shortcuts in the first 6 months, because first 6 months what you are preparing is not for the exam. You are preparing to prepare for the exam. Okay. By that I mean, the questions in general studies for pre, mains, or in optional you are directly preparing, especially for general studies, you hardly see that any question in mains comes directly from the book. In prelims they do come. This time this was also negated in 2018. So you are in the first 4 or 5 or 6 months of your preparation, especially for people like me who did not have any background of humanities. I'm an engineer. So for people like me, the first 4, 5, 6 months become very important, in the sense that here you prepare to prepare for the exam. You need to get your basics clear. In this 6 months at least, don't go for shortcuts. Try to understand every topic. If you don't understand what the constitution says about a particular thing, if you don't understand what is the phenomena in geography, you will not be able to attend the question of why Delhi is more polluted than Mumbai or Calcutta having same amount of traffic. Okay, so for that, in order to answer that question, you have to know about the basic geography of Delhi, Mumbai and Calcutta, not in the name of Delhi, Mumbai and Calcutta, but you have to visualize it. And for that visualization, you have to get your basics clear. Okay, so read the basic books over and over again. Keep smaller sources so that you are able to revise in a short period of time, because generally after the, since I have been giving prelims mains interview 4 times, I have never got time to study anything more. I have been giving interview and in the next 20 days always there is prelims. Okay, except for this time, fortunately. So in 20 days you don't get selected or you don't get the desired service. You already have a hole in your heart that you didn't get it. So within 2-3 days you have to shift the trigger and come to the mode and then start your studies. So this is the time when you are getting 5-6 months to study the entire thing, then you will get just 20 days, and that you can do only if your sources are small and comprehensive. I don't mean by small that you take up a source which does not have entire thing, but it is small plus comprehensive. Okay, this is the first thing. And second thing is, try to read one source. Try to make one base source, because if you make multiple sources, the output is very less. First of all, you'll end up reading everything but consolidating nothing. So you have to conquer, but after that, the most important thing is consolidation. You conquered a particular area, but then you left it. Then you went to some other area. That particular area that you conquered will be conquered by someone else. You have conquered it. Now you have to raise an army, you have to convince the people of that area that no, I am a just leader. Only then consolidation is done. That consolidation has to be done in the course also, or else your work is not done. So take a single source, study that source, revise it, and make room for revision before the exam. That is the most important thing, because revision and staying calm are the keys, are the two keys to clear this exam. If you are calm and if you can revise it over and over again, you can clear this exam. But if you somehow face, no, I cannot do it, my life, even if it, just remember that you are preparing for a coveted service. You are, the most important thing is the curriculum. The curriculum is making you sensitized. You know about each and every issue that is happening throughout the world. So definitely you will be able to contribute this knowledge in whatsoever field you aspire to in future. This is just a result. There can be better results if you don't get good result now. There can be. Even our president attempted for the civil service exam and he did not become an IAS. If you would have become an IAS, maybe you would have retired as a bureaucrat. Now he went on to become the president of India. So you never know that today you are ahead of someone, somebody else will accomplish more than you in future. So always stay calm, make room for revision, and always see that even if there are setbacks, always see that there is always a silver lining surrounding every dark cloud. Okay, and there is always a light coming at the end of the tunnel. So, and be happy. That's the most important thing. Thank you. Anything else? Okay, not end. Okay. How to? The mic also does not want me to continue, I feel. Okay. About current affairs. See, current affairs have become very important. So especially I used to read 1 year current affairs prior to the exam. But after analyzing this year's question paper, I feel that one should go for reading 2 years current affairs for both prelims and mains, because questions asked were on additional protocol. Additional protocol I read in my second attempt in 2015. that India signed the additional protocol for some of its nuclear power plants. So these kind of things are coming now. So at least 2 years current affairs. So for that, I would suggest reading the newspaper, because if you read the newspaper, your perspectives develop. You become more sensitized about certain things which can't be given by the coaching materials, the magazines. So reading the articles definitely give you a feel. But at the same time, reading materials have also become very necessary, because searching for facts in the newspaper is practically like searching a needle in a haystack. Okay, so you will just keep on searching, you won't get any output in return. So read the newspaper daily, no need to make notes. That was an inefficient method that I followed before. So after reading the newspaper, just before the exam, take up the compilations. Because the compilations are very exhaustive, they are comprehensive, they consist of everything that happened throughout the year, and they make your work a lot easier. That's why. So, or kuch? Haan. So, for example, the question that you said about who connects the ATMs. So it was NPCI, right?
Yes.
The answer. So this kind of things will be developed, I feel. I also developed that in due course. In the first attempt, it did not come. In due course, when you read a lot, you know what NPCI does. Okay, NPCI is a body, an organization, not-for-profit organization, which is to enable and make the payments in India easy. Okay, so that the payments become easy and financial inclusion can be reached. So NPCI is a body mandated to do that. So definitely, when it comes to ATMs, what ATMs does? What ATMs do? ATMs make the payments easy. You can get cash from anywhere and everywhere. And what does connection of ATM mean? Connection of ATM means by using card of any bank, you can get cash from the ATM of another bank. So ultimately, it is financial inclusion, making the payments easy. So making the payments easy is a mandate of NPCI. So in that way, it is NPCI. RBI tha shayad option mein usme. RBI nahi hoga. So it is NPCI. So in that way, that's why I say that not only books or not only newspapers, even people are talking around. You meet a friend, you meet anyone, while in a trip or a journey, you come across a magazine. Just go through, just flip through the pages. You will see something and that gets registered in your mind. So, and that creates a knowledge base, and that will help you finally in the exam. Basic books to padhna hi hai, theek hai. To uske saath saath matlab bahar ka internet achhi tarike se use kijiye. And along with that, I would say, no need to memorize, but read the things that everyone reads. Since you are here in old Rajinder Nagar, even for the people who are preparing from other parts of India, my message is that it's okay if you leave a question which is not known to anyone, but it would turn out to be a disaster if you leave a question which is done by everyone. So I also followed this principle: don't leave a source that everyone reads. Okay, so keep on track of what is the trend going on in the UPSC hubs of the country, and try to know what people are reading, and then have your own reasoned action based on which one is the most moderated and calibrated source. That's all I can say. Anything else? So all the best. I hope everyone will come out with flying colors in the exam. Thank you. Thank you so much.